On this week's episode, we'll show you how to securely run graphical applications in a jail, we'll sit down and chat with OpenBSD founder Theo de Raadt, and as always, we'll get you caught up on all the latest news. All that and more this week on BSD Now, the place to be SD.
I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude. On this week, our top story is Hammer 2, the file system in Dragonfly BSD, just finished its Google Summer of Code, and a bunch of extra changes have been merged in.
It looks like it's been focused on compression, using I/O structure to work with compression.
Yeah. They've been using... sorry. They've implemented LZ4 and Zlib, which is a gzip compression, and some other stuff. It looks quite interesting.
Oh, cool.
They've also...
Looks like they added bootability, too, for Hammer 2 volumes.
Yes, which obviously is useful if you want to boot.
Yeah. It is helpful to be able to boot from the file system you intend to run. All right. Very cool. Looks like in the show notes, of course, we'll have a full list of the additions and improvements, so feel free to take a look.
The full mailing list post, which breaks down the different work and who did it and so on.
Okay. So next up in the news here, OS News has started a BSD family segment. So I guess it looks like an OS News reader decided to share some info about the BSDs, and he's writing a three-part series covering free, open, and net BSD, and looks like a lot of good info if you're somebody on Linux interested in switching over.
It looks like he missed the release of 9.2 by like a couple of days.
Oh, missed it by that much.
Right, but you know, he's probably been researching the story for a while, so it probably would have been 9.2 even after. So
sure. But still, that's a really good way to get your feet wet and kind of start learning about the family.
It's kind of targeted towards Linux switchers, so people that are used to Linux and would like to give FreeBSD a try or one of the other BSDs, and it kind of provides it from a different perspective that I think will make sense to a lot of people.
Oh, very cool. So what's next up, Alan?
The next story is Package Source, the system kind of like ports for NetBSD, has branched their 2013 Q3 version. The way the Package Source works, they do one complete set every quarter. And so this is the one for fall, basically.
Okay, so they release a quarterly package set, and then do they do any security updates or anything in between that time, or is it just a one-shot deal?
I'm actually not sure. I think they do. I don't actually know.
Don't know off the top of your head. Well, it looks like in the notes here that they have about 13,184, so that's a very specific number of packages available for AMD64, so that's pretty cool. Yep. And if anybody in the community has interest, we can try and get a tutorial written for this in the future.
Yes. Interestingly, also, Joyent's SmartOS, which I think is based on OpenSolaris, uses Package Source now.
Oh, okay. That's cool. So it's being picked up even in non-BSD projects.
And NetBSD has support for Clang in there as well, although Joyent still uses GCC.
Sure.
And it's like 180 new packages, 4 of them renamed, 15 removed, and 1,366 were updated.
Oh, very cool. Okay, next up here, something I know a little bit about. We just announced pcbsd 9.2 a couple days back. And of course, this is right after FreeBSD 9.2 came out. We just had a few days to get our images rolled, packages all staged and ready to go. But the highlights in this release is going to be bootable ZFS environments.
Yes.
So if you're somebody who's come from the Solaris world and know how ZFS works and how you can snapshot and then be able to reboot and choose a previous snapshot to boot up off of, we're doing the same thing in PCBSD now. We've also rewritten our Life Preserver utility, which is essentially a backup utility. It has command line and graphical versions, and it leverages ZFS to do snapshots, to do replication to remote systems. And the cool feature is, once you've replicated, say your system just blows up or burns down in a fire or something, you can grab the installed DVD and restore from that remote replication. Yeah. So across the wire, at any point later on.
And the other thing is with your PEFS home directory encryption, the encryption mm-hmm. happens above ZFS. So when you replicate it, it stays encrypted. Whereas if you do the traditional FreeBSD Geli encryption, that's between ZFS and the disk. And so if you replicate, if you do a ZFS send, the sent copy is not encrypted.
Yeah, it's just the raw data you're sending. With PEFs, and then anything you create a snapshot, the snapshot still stays encrypted, so you're not actually ever sending raw data across the wire. You don't have to worry about people sniffing your network traffic, etc. But in addition to that, we've improved the package NG support, so we have a full package NG repo we're updating every couple weeks now, so you can build and manage your entire server or desktop using that. We've updated the App Cafe, so downloading applications, searching a lot easier, and a lot of improvements to the Warden, which is a jail management system for PCBSD or FreeBSD. And last but not least, we've added a GUI package NG manager. So there's a graphical way to browse the package NG repository, all 20 some odd thousand packages. And then you can update via that too. So you just got a nice updating tab and you say, oh, cool, these are ready. Let's update them, and away it goes.
And updating with PackageNG is so nice.
Yeah, it's so much easier. So it is pretty cool. But yeah, we've linked all that stuff in. So if you guys want to take a look at it, all the images are now up on the website.
And the boot environments thing, the menu is amazing. I've used it to great effect during the EuroBSD con. I set up my laptop with all of it the week before EuroBSDCon, because the FreeBSD install that was on my laptop hadn't been touched since BSDCAN. And it needed some love. So I updated it to the latest PC-BSD, and then I also used a boot environment to install current so I could run Beehive. And you know, now I'm actually using it quite a bit. I'm developing all these patches for BSD install on it.
And, to do that as well.
So... yes, the new PCBSD is nice.
Well, one thing really cool about boot environments, for those who've not run them, we're able to snap not only your kernel and world, but that'll include your packages as well. But the things we don't snap would be like your home directory. So you could, as Alan's doing, have a 9.2 install and a 10.0 install and a 9.3 install all in the same box, and then just pick which one to boot from, and you still have the same home contents when you boot up. So all your data is still there, your files you maybe want to work on, but you can basically switch your operating system on the fly, which is pretty cool.
Yes,
that's right. Okay, so that's the roundup for the main news items this week. Next up, we have an interview with Theo de Raadt, the founder and I guess lead developer, is that what you would call him for the OpenBSD project? But definitely a very interesting interview that we recorded with him last week in Malta. So go ahead and listen up, and we'll take it away and give it to Theo.
So for this week's interview, we're joined by Theo de Raadt, the founder of OpenBSD. Thank you for joining us.
Hey, thanks for being here. Why don't you go ahead and give us a little bit of background about yourself, the history of OpenBSD, how this all got started?
So... I don't even remember the years. It's been so long. When soon after the 386 BSD stuff came out from Jolitz, NetBSD was formed, and I was one of the first four people involved in NetBSD. Simultaneously, of course, FreeBSD was being started right next door downtown in California. And NetBSD, in the NetBSD tree, we started incorporating all the other architectures and stuff like that, and continuing on, we really saw ourselves as a continuation of CSRG, now that CSRG was dead. And then a conflict happened in NetBSD, and NetBSD kicked me out. So this soon resulted, so over the next year, it was very difficult for me to continue collaboration with all the developers who I already knew in the community, because I didn't have access to a repository, and that had become the lifeblood of the process. It was the only way to do things anymore. The old way of submitting diffs via email to people wasn't vibrant enough. So enough people belonged to my side of the development process that it became time to create a new repository. And this was the genesis of OpenBSD. During that time also, somebody, I don't know who, did a security attack against a syslog, our syslog unit. and I once again became very interested in security.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where things began.
And sure. So is that kind of guiding where you guys have gone with OpenBSD ever since now? Is that the sparking incident?
I'd say so. It's I had been involved in security before, mm-hmm. Because at the University of Calgary, before even before NetBSD, I'd been a system administrator and I'd had access to SANOS source code.
Sure.
So I'd actually found security holes in SANOS libc and mm-hmm. submitted them up through to the Sun people, and also actually communicated with people in the BSD community directly, like mm-hmm. Keith Bostick and Paul Vixie and such, to get these bugs fixed. So it was just sort of I've been in the security and quality sphere before. Mm-hmm. It was just a refresh. You know, it's just like Damon gets attacked.
Yeah, yeah.
So. And that's kind of what got started with the idea of auditing all the code?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what sets OpenBSD apart now instead.
Yeah, so the auditing led to led later on, I suppose, to the after a year or so, led to the concept of auditing is not enough.
Mm-hmm.
And then sub-projects started showing up around the net that we work aware of. Like, for example, Eto's work on ProPolice, mm-hmm. which was not being accepted into the GCC community.
Sure.
And it had some problems, and it was incomplete. And other developers started being involved and trying to fix that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it just sort of, it's so far back in the past, and it's almost difficult, I think, to remember the order in which things happened.
That's a great sign, though, when the project's gotten that far along that you can't even remember some of the original stuff. Like, we've survived that long, that's still a cool thing. Give us a little bit of description about the community. You guys do things a little bit different in OpenBSD. I know you hold hackathons. Give us some of the reasoning behind that. Why?
How they work.
How they work.
One thing that we've tried to do is, since the growth of our project has been slow, and since there's no corporate influence, all the people are very much individuals.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I'm in Calgary, but most of our developers are actually in Europe.
Sure.
It's this real mix of global people who don't meet each other. But being a small group at the start, interested in the same technology, I really tried to encourage the social relationships where people would speak to each other and chat and get to know each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so eventually it became clear, especially because we had DARPA money for a while there, mm-hmm. to go and run these events to get everybody together at a place. Sort of near Usenix conferences or not. And it was so successful, but then the DARPA money went away. Mm-hmm. So then we found a way to actually run them inexpensively by asking universities.
Sure.
Some of the people have, some of the developers have enough money so they can pay for their own rooms.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody pays for their own flight.
Uh-huh.
It's really worked at building a community, and that's about all.
Okay.
So really the social aspect, I think, is what sets OpenBSD apart.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's rare to have a group of 100 developers who also have such strong social relations.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like you said, they go hiking together and things like that.
Yeah, they go hiking together. Yeah.
And in contrast to projects like FreeBSD, you have almost no formal policies. It's more of a consensus. Cool. And just you do the right thing, because otherwise people yell at you.
We end up with people who are domain experts in their areas.
Mm-hmm.
And we try not to slow the process down too much.
Mm-hmm.
I act a bit like a coordinator of last resort to make sure that time slots are available in the tree.
Mm-hmm.
Before our next release,
right.
To make sure that two conflicting changes don't go in at the same time. And I don't mean conflicting
sure.
changes as with respect to overlapping inside the same source code files, but as regards debuggability. Mm-hmm. If a problem happens, and we need to be able to determine which one is causing it, sure. Like let's say a machine lockup, we wouldn't want an intrusive change in the file system code to arrive at the same time as something in like for example, the KMS display code mm-hmm. at the same time, right. Because a machine, a lockup may be very hard to diagnose. So for example, those are given slight offsets and times so that we can isolate them.
Right. So speaking of the KMS code, I got to give the OpenBSD community major props for this, but you guys are big fans of eating your own dog food. When I see all the OpenBSD guys out, they're all running it on their laptops because they trust their own code. They run their own stuff. Yeah. That is very impressive. Yeah.
It's easy for us on laptops, of course, because they suspend.
Sure.
And so there's no problem. For example, my laptop, which I have at this conference, is actually running quite old KMS code, very early KMS code. It's actually somewhere around 6 months old because I actually haven't upgraded the laptop yet because I've done over 400 suspend resumes on it.
Oh, there you go.
So I just haven't had time.
Do you
on
guys
this
have,
particular
a,
laptop.
Have a record or something up on the website to see who's gone the longest?
I think Mike Larkin has actually set up one of his laptops to do automatic sleeps and wake-ups and reached over 3,000. And I think he's also done that in QEMU instances. Mm-hmm. A lot of the development early on was done in Box and QEMU.
Sure.
And he's actually someone who should probably talk to as well. He has some very interesting stories and insights about how his low-level components of that were.
So what did you guys have to implement to make it so rock solid like that? What was the magic, if it were?
It's nice that we have our own ACPI stack, okay. And we understand every component of it. Beyond that, there were just some design decisions for how the device tree hierarchy would actually be used to ensure that devices are suspended and resumed in the right order. And we were lucky that the device tree on most machines was almost in the right hierarchy already, and we only had to make a few small changes to the hierarchy. Beyond that, you end up with some very machine-specific registers, or MTRRs, or such more CPU-specific, and it took many cycles reading the completely incomplete and incorrect ACPI specification to figure out what the exact order of operation should be. And we think we still have a few problems over there dealing with some timers and such, but it's pretty solid.
I guess one of the biggest things with OpenBSD is you have a lot more rapid and I guess consistent development cycle, especially compared to BSD.
Yes, and well, that's also perhaps because we don't really run any branches.
Right.
Right. So all the developers are in the same code path moving forward, and all of our user community is also in that if they decide to go run our snapshots. And they're encouraged to run the snapshots because testing of code there will result in the next release being high quality.
Right, and means that the developers get feedback in a timely manner.
Yes.
In FreeBSD, all the developers run ahead, but all the users are one or two branches below that. And so when they find bugs, the developers moved on quite a while ago.
And he's forgotten where he's at, and
he has
to rewind his memory to it, remember why he did it, remember who else he was doing it with,
right.
And if anybody else has moved on or is too busy somewhere else, see, you've lost a moment where the code was alive.
Right.
And sometimes the developer's gone at that point. It was just a flyby patch. And
it happens.
Now it's like, oh, who was the guy who submitted that again? Where did that come from?
Huh? And sometimes it's someone who has come from the outside, who is a significant domain expert.
Sure.
And if it hadn't been for that person arriving, you wouldn't have been able to do it at all.
Right. Mm-hmm. And you didn't capitalize on that moment when you had them.
Right.
And that's something I think the previous debugger could learn a lot from OpenBSD there.
So for the listeners, we're at Malta at EuroBSDCon right now. Theo gave the opening keynote, and I know it's recorded, so it'll be online later, but could you give a small little synopsis of it, kind of to whet their appetite to go out and watch it?
Okay, I spoke about 64-bit time key.
Mm-hmm.
And the need to solve the problem almost immediately, because the risks are very great that 32-bit machines will still be with us in 25 years. We need to get ahead of the release of the upgrade cycle that occurs in industry, especially in industry for our critical infrastructure.
Yeah, things like the SCADA systems, they never replace them. Right? They had an example with the CANDU nuclear reactors, they're still run by a PDP-11.
They use PDP-11s for their pump controllers.
Yeah,
so that's a 40-year-old technology.
Sure.
Right.
40-year-old technology deployment, it actually predates 40 years, yes.
Oh, man. Yeah.
So if things would last 40 years, it's already too late to solve 2038.
I think our upgrade cycles are a little bit faster,
sure.
But I think 25 years doesn't give us many cycles. Like
sure.
Maybe the upgrade cycle in SCADA is 7 years, maybe it's 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have much time. Mm-hmm. We need to get not just our own, not just the BSDs over this curve, but we need to get all the other POSIX systems over this curve,
sure.
And because the deployment of them is increasing.
Yeah.
And many people will think that the deployment of 64-bit machines is increasing, but behind the back, what happens is all of the 32-bit embedded machines and 16-bit embedded machines are now becoming POSIX systems running on 32-bit CPUs.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So there's an increase there, which is very scary.
Mm. Yeah.
So.
And the other thing you mentioned in that is the kind of model that OpenBSD has adopted as being an incubator for good ideas.
Yeah, we incubate good ideas, and that requires us to be very proactive with change.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There is a talk by Rob Pike which says that operating system research is dead, and it's perhaps true. He seems to almost blame POSIX for that, to kind of suggest that because POSIX is the framework that everybody now operates on, nobody changes POSIX anymore.
Sure.
I think it goes beyond that, and the issue perhaps may be that backwards compatibility is king, and therefore, the only work which gets done in the operating system today is to either increase performance or something behind the scenes, or on the other side, to glom on a new bag.
Sure.
Yes, just bolt things on the side.
New things on, because new things don't break compatibility.
Right.
But we are starting to hit a whole bunch of problems, not just time T, which of course has a fixed schedule ahead of us, but other sorts of things which are holding us back. And we're not able to clean up our architecture and up our game anymore.
Because we have this
backwards compatibility.
Yeah. Well, and just human nature, laziness too, because if I break that, it means we gotta go fix it. Who wants to spend the time doing that?
Well,
I'm sure there's some of that too, you know?
There is, but a lot of the backwards compatibility is excessive.
Mm-hmm.
And it's code paths which don't get tested.
Sure.
The kernel is getting bloated. It's harder to understand old components we're running these days. So in OpenBSD, on contrast, what we do is we remove backwards compatibility on a regular basis because, for example, we've just changed time T to long, long. So we can immediately realize that all of our other backwards compatibility efforts are useless.
Yeah.
So we just, at the same time, remove them all.
A complete clean break.
Yep.
It's a clean break.
Clean slate.
Now we move forward until we hit the next hurdle where we go, oh, we should have done that a while ago and crossed over and gone to 60. Well, in this case, we went to 64-bit inode T at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other crossings that we want to do as well.
Yeah, well, Chris had the same problem with pc-bsd, right?
Yeah.
He found that all the developers are using 64-bit machines, so his i386 version would have
not getting tested code at all. What was happening was we'd have a major critical bug in the 32-bit that nobody would notice for 3 months. You know? And I'm like, oh man, how many people...
Some user run into it.
Yeah. But that's just the nature of the beast now, unfortunately.
Yeah. That can be the problem with some... You know, for PCBSD, i386 is an exotic architecture. For you guys, you have some much crazier things.
And especially i386 is not, because there's ALEX isn't used by all of our developers and almost all of their network edges, some little ALEX shout somewhere. So i386 is not dead.
Well, yeah, even in FreeBSD, it's definitely not dead.
No, my use case is very specific with ZFS and
ZFS desktop
stuff.
That's kind of specific.
Yep. Well, very cool. This has been fascinating, Theo. Anything else? Any projects you guys have upcoming that you want to just give a mention to get people curious about?
No, just watch the tree.
Just watch the tree. Okay. Well, there
Lots
you go. You have it.
Yeah. We keep track of it and try to tell people every time we see something interesting.
Yeah, we're following it every week with news and whatnot.
OpenBSD has most of the interesting stuff.
Thank you.
Well, just really quick, so for the Linux users watching, I know there's a lot of you guys out there maybe aren't as familiar with OpenBSD. What are some of the notable things that have come out of OpenBSD that maybe you were all using and didn't realize that's where it came from?
Well, I guess that would be OpenSSH.
Right.
But even TMUX, right?
TMUX did not come out of OpenBSD.
But it was
Nicholas had already written it all, and then I became aware that there was a screen replacement, and that same day he had an account.
There you go.
And once he had an account, the idea was that other developers were immediately able to accelerate his process and tune it up. So,
is that where Sudo got it started as well?
No, Sudo has a much, much older history.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
I know Mike, got a guy writing a book about it, Michael Lucas. Sorry about that, Michael. Yes. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. And of course, PF.
PF as well.
Open BGPD and a bunch of other projects all got their start in OpenBSD.
Yes, so we thank you for all those, because we're using a number of those things on our end too.
It's a team effort. It's a team effort.
It's awesome, though.
Yes.
Well, cool. Well, any other questions you have, Alan?
No, I don't. Because
I know you got to catch a flight, but thank you so much for spending some time with us and with the community, and hope to catch you at another conference.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We ran into some minor technical difficulties while recording this tutorial, so Chris had to leave, but I'll run you through the tutorial anyway. So the first thing we need to do is to log into our jail, which I've created ahead of time. On another episode, we'll show you how to use EasyJail to create and manage your jails. So I'm just going to console into the jail I created called VMC. And so now I'm in, and the first thing I need to do is install all the packages that I'm going to need to do that. You can do that from ports, or I'm just going to use the pcbsd package in grepo, and we'll just install xorg, openbox, and type vmc. And then the other thing we need to do is get the patch. There's a small patch required for the VNC server to make it operate in jail. And so we'll just grab that from the website there, vncserver.patch. And then we can apply that to the binary that was installed. And there we go. So now what we have to do is configure the VNC server. So we'll make the VNC directory in our home directory. And then we will create a file called xstartup, which is the list of commands that will start up when x does. And so we want to do just some basic stuff here. Start openbox so that we have a window manager, and then start an x term so that we can see what's going on. And you could replace that x term with whatever application you wanted to run in this jail. And then we'll make that executable. And now we can start the VNC server. Then we set a password so that not just anyone can connect to our VNC. And now that that's running, I can set up my VNC client. Log in. Now if I can just quickly flip the shot for you. Now you can see I'm VNC'd into the virtual machine. And I can do whatever I want, and this is actually happening in the jail. It's happening in the jail on my FreeBSD machine. And that's it for the tutorial. It's fairly straightforward, but quite powerful.
Okay, in this upcoming event, we're going to be looking at the place to be, SD, upcoming events, things you can attend that are BSD related. So first up, we got VBSDCon coming October 25th to the 27th, and the website's vbsdcon.com, and there'll be a link in the show notes, of course.
That's hosted by VeriSign, the guys that run the .com and .net infrastructure. Partly on FreeBSD. And
a little company, I'm sure you've never heard of them, right? But this is going to be taking place at the Dulles Hyatt in Virginia here in the States.
Just outside of Washington, D.C.
So it looks like it's a hybrid unconference, which for those who aren't familiar with what that is, we've done this at MeetBSD on the West Coast in California before.
And
it's a little less formal.
That's what this is inspired by. One of the guys from VeriSign went to MeetBSD and had such a great time, he decided, let's do one on the East Coast.
Yeah, so think of your typical conference. You go, you listen to a lecture for 45 minutes to an hour. Yeah, 70% of the people are on their laptop chatting on IRC and answering email. And yeah, that's pretty much a conference, right? Well, the unconference, you literally have like an MC who goes and tells everyone to put away their laptops, and we actually like communicate in real life. It's weird, yeah. Right?
The hybrid part, like with an unconference, there'd be no lecture style at all. With the hybrid, you know, there's a couple of lecture style, and then it's mixed in with the more informal social, hey, everybody pay attention and let's do something.
Let's actually talk face to face and like hash out some problems and figure out some solutions before we start opening up our laptops and coding. So it's definitely a cool format. And if you can get to the Dulles Hyatt in Virginia, come on out. I think registrations are still open, right, Alan?
Still open. And you and I will both be there, right? Yeah, you're speaking.
Definitely.
Right?
Yes, I'm speaking there. So I look forward to meeting you guys if anybody can come on out. So what's the next event we got?
Other speakers at VBSDCon will include Baptiste, who we have an interview with that we haven't managed to air yet, but he'll be there. Devin Teske, who we interviewed previously with the Epic Beard, he'll be there talking more about his tools, and I look forward to meeting him in person because him and I have been collaborating quite a bit over the last 2 weeks, actually. Scott Long will actually be talking about something that's not Netflix. In his role, he was the FreeBSD release engineer before Glenn Barber, who we interviewed a couple weeks ago. And so he's giving a talk about getting rid of the stigma of the .0 release, which is a big thing, especially with 10 coming up. And then
very timely.
Luigi Rizzo and David Chisnell will also be giving talks.
Okay. Yeah, lots of good speakers. And then, of course, the unconference stuff in between should be a lot of fun.
Henning Brower and Rick Floater from OpenBSD are also giving talks.
Very cool. Okay, so next event we have pretty much right after VBSDCon on the complete opposite coast.
The next weekend,
is the IX Systems hosting the FreeBSD 20th anniversary party.
Yes.
So how cool is that? So what's going on with this, Alan?
So it's going to take place at the DNA Lounge in San Francisco, which coincidentally is where the 10th anniversary party was held.
Sure.
So it just goes to show that. You know, that little connection to the history there. It's just basically a one-night party. There'll be a lot of different FreeBSD people there, newer ones and older ones and everything. And so I'm looking forward. I'm going to that as well.
Oh, okay. Excellent. Yeah, I just booked my tickets yesterday. So I will be out there as
last week, I guess. So, yeah. I look forward to seeing you again.
Yeah. If any of you guys are on the West Coast or can get out to San Francisco, come on out on the November 2nd.
Yeah, so basically, if you're on the East Coast or the West Coast, there's an event, and you have no excuse not to come out.
Well, let me check here real quick. The website for rsvp.ixsystems, that's where you'll go. Looks like there's only 57 slots left because they had a cap on the number of people could attend. So go to the website. If you can come, go ahead and sign up and get that RSVP in before it fills up.
Yep, because I have a feeling it will fill up because it's going to be a big party.
Sure. Okay. And next up, we're going to go ahead and hit the news roundup really quickly, some of the notables that occurred this last week. So what's our first item here, Alan?
A Curve 25519 patch for OpenSSH. Because of the recent NSA news, they're implementing an alternative key exchange mechanism instead of the traditional Diffie-Hellman in case you just want to do something different.
Sure. Well, that's good. And having more choice as far as different different keys is always a good thing to have.
Yeah. So this is the way that you exchange the keys to do the encryption afterwards. It's interesting. And it comes from the developer of libssh, and it's already implemented in libssh as well.
Very cool. Well, next up, they announced a FreeBSD 10 Alpha 5. I guess the ISOs are up on the site now.
Including VM images, which is something kind of very new cool that they've been doing. That you can get pre-built QCOW or VMDK images in order to just run it right in a virtual machine.
Sure.
And, you know, the big things FreeBSD 10 are much better Beehive and Xen, more GNU stuff removed. Bind is gone.
Bind for DNS, yeah.
A lot of Beehive stuff came in after EuroBSD Con, so it wasn't an Alpha 4 and it is an Alpha 5, including AHCI support, so you can emulate a CD-ROM to boot off of and stuff.
Cool.
And attach disks that way as well if you want, although the Vertio block device driver is probably better performance-wise, but that's a bunch of Google Summer of Code stuff that came in, and also a bunch of improvements to make the Linux booting work better.
Oh, very cool. Okay. So definitely check out Alpha 5, and I think this will probably be the last one before they go to Beta 1.
Yes, so I think the stable branch is supposed to be cut tomorrow or Friday, I think.
Yeah, and I think they said the 10th.
Yeah, and then the Beta 1 should be the 12th or so. That really puts me up against the wall to get my patch for BSD install done today.
Yeah, no, same here. We're trying to get a 10 image roll to pc-bsd to coincide with Beta 1. So we're trying to push and get this done.
Right.
Too.
Well, I guess you're waiting for the stable branch, right?
Well, I've already tagged my own because we roll our own Git repo of what FreeBSD's got. So I just changed the tag. Yeah. But either way, I wanted to at least correspond and come out roughly the same time.
Yeah. Lots of active development going on there.
Yep. Okay. It looks like next up, MTier is now offering long time support for OpenBSD ports.
Oh, interesting.
So what is this, Alan? What's going on?
So they're offering a subscription to LTS support in addition to their free six-month version. So you can get support for up to 6 months for free, and if you need longer, then there's a subscription fee. Normally, OpenBSD releases are only supported for 1 year. Therefore, 5.2 becomes unsupported when 5.4 comes out, because they do every six-month release cycle. You know, if you want to pay, MTier will basically backport security fixes and stuff and provide longer term support in case you're in a position where upgrading is a problem.
Not feasible at the time, sure. Okay, well, that sounds really cool. That'll make it easier for some corporate customers and folks who need to rely on that LTS.
Deploying OpenBSD in an appliance, and it's as the appliance manufacturer, you don't get to decide when the customer upgrades.
Yeah, that's true. Very cool. Okay, next up we have Ohio Linux Fest happened a few weeks back, and I guess they've gone ahead and uploaded all the talks. Those are videos, Alan, or are they just audio? Okay, videos. So notables, it includes Kirk McCusick's keynote about building the building an open source community.
It does look like it's only audio.
Only audio. Okay. Well, still, either way, it's a good listen. Yep. Throw it on your podcast device.
I would like to hear Kirk McCusick's keynote from the Linux Fest.
Yeah, and my brother Kenny was actually out there and gave a talk about some of the PCBSD developments that went into 9.2, so you can definitely listen to that as well.
Yeah.
Okay, looks like lastly here we have something about Theo from the OpenBSD project. What's been going on with him?
So he posted on the MISC mailing list kind of explaining why he's not been around so much lately and dealing with, there was a bit of a controversy over a fake Twitter account. At Theo de Raadt, which has actually since been suspended. But it was causing the reason Theo hasn't been around so much is he's been working to start an internet exchange in Calgary. Calgary, Alberta is a place in Canada, and it's the worst place in the world as far as latency to a DNS server. Out of every possible place in the G20 countries, it was the one that was the furthest from a DNS root server. And so they starting an internet exchange and have a DNS root server installed in it already. So this will be quite an improvement, I think.
Yeah, that's a very laudable project. That's cool he's able to work on that.
Yep, and it'll do a bunch of other things and just generally improve the internet in Canada and mean that there'll be more diverse routes for sending traffic through Canada without having to go through the states.
They won't have to ping back to Chicago or something,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. There's an interesting post there if you want to get into that a little bit. And we talked with Theo a little bit about that, but outside of the interview, I think. It'll be interesting.
Okay. Well, cool. Well, that's the news roundup for this week. But next up, we have a couple questions that have been sent in. We're going to try and answer them to the best of our ability. Yeah. First up, Kenneth is writing in with a question. You see here, first of all, he really likes the show. Awesome. Thanks, Ken. Likes reading the how-tos. Ta-da. Looks like he was asking about a general setup that includes a kind of a tutorial on how we install, how we get updated, etc. So kind of a brief rundown. Is that something you think we could do at some point, Alan?
I think TJ before has also talked about doing an installathon episode, just walking through mm-hmm. the installer of all the different BSDs.
Sure.
That would really that would showcase be a lot of fun. How great the pc-bsd one is.
Yeah, well, we'll save that for last, yeah. Right? Okay, now that you've spent 10 minutes, oh, here you go. Now you're done. Very cool.
But yeah, he was also asking about, you know, how to set up DNS, DHCP, SAMBA, mm-hmm. SSH, IRC, all that kind of stuff. And sure. Yes, we will get into those tutorials as much as we can. We have lots of ideas to tutorials, but we'd love to hear what you guys want to see in the tutorials, because mm-hmm. that's how we write the tutorials that are most popular, is when you tell us what you'd actually like to see.
Sure. Yeah, so those are definitely ones I'm sure we'll do something on DNS or setting up Samba or SSH in the future. And of course, maybe we can show it on a variety of BSDs just in case the files are located in different spots. Yep. Okay, so what's the next question we got
so
here?
So the next question was about TrueOS. It was asking, other than the cool name and artwork, what are the advantages of using TrueOS over just vanilla FreeBSD?
Okay, well, since I'm responsible for that, I'll just give you a brief rundown. TrueOS is essentially just FreeBSD. It includes some stuff that's not in and out-of-box FreeBSD, though. So we've patched in PEFSFS, the encryption module. Yep. It's got all of our utilities. It's got basically all the command line versions of pcbsd utilities, and it's tied into our FreeBSD update server, our package ng repo, etc. And for legal reasons, I just don't call it FreeBSD because it's FreeBSD plus a bunch of stuff. So that's basically what it is. So if you're a Linux user and you just want to get a FreeBSD server up and running and you need something where out of box you got Git and Subversion and Bash and utilities that you're already familiar with, TrueOS is probably going to be the way you want to go.
Right. So he also asked, you know, do you know how many people are actually using TrueOS?
Not TrueOS specifically. The stats come in, they look the same from both. Right. So I just see it as FreeBSD 9.2 or whatever. But I'll have to add some feature where we can track that a little bit more generically.
And I was just wondering, do you see there being much of a future for TrueOS once FreeBSD has package ng and you could just grab the pcbsd tools as add-on?
We'll see. Yeah, we've got ideas for TrueOS, mm-hmm. things that we want to add. We're a little bit more proactive as far as pushing things into the system than FreeBSD can be.
Right, you get to be a little more cutting edge.
Yeah, a good example would be we use Grub to boot TrueOS and PCBSD, and not because we love the GPL or really wanted to use Grub, but it gives us ZFS boot environments. Right. So that means in an out-of-box install on your server, you get boot environments, and now you can act like a Solaris box and say, okay, I'm going to upgrade my kernel. I should probably create a boot environment. Yeah. So that's a feature. I'm not sure when that's going to hit FreeBSD. It might be a year out or more. Right. So we're probably always going to be using TrueOS as a place we can push stuff out a little bit faster to you guys before it makes it into mainline FreeBSD.
Yeah, I think it's a good kind of, you know, incubator for some of the cool stuff, or just
that's essentially what it is. It
allows you to just get ahead of the curve, right? Because FreeBSD mm-hmm. by its nature is kind of conservative, and so
mm-hmm. But you need those little laboratories out there where you can experiment and start pushing new technology and prove it and then push it into FreeBSD. Yep. So we've done a lot of the same with all of our utilities, graphical and command line. We've added to the FreeBSD port streams last week. So you can easily convert a FreeBSD box into PCBSD or TrueOS if you want. Yep. Okay, next up, it looks like Alan wrote in. So he has some questions about FreeBSD and cPanel. So
He's using cPanel, which is a web hosting mm-hmm. control panel software. Basically, lets you... provides a web interface for your users to manage their part of a web server. And he was asking, you know, if there's some FreeBSD combo that would work for their setup. cPanel used to support FreeBSD, but I don't think they do anymore. What I use is DirectAdmin, which is very similar software, except for it also supports FreeBSD. Although I do a slightly customized version of their install. I don't use their installer. I do it myself with the port tree, or mm-hmm. actually, if I did it again now, it'd actually be with package ng mostly, I think. Sure. Although I'd still be using my own package ng repo because I compile, you know, my Apache is compiled quite a bit differently than most people's.
Yeah, you got a lot of special flags and stuff turned on, I'm sure.
But yes, I've been using DirectAdmin since 2005, 2005 or so, okay. Maybe even earlier. So I'm quite happy with it. I bought a lifetime license a very long time ago, so I don't even have to pay for it anymore. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's basically the same idea as cPanel. It's a little less cluttered, and I like it. And I think that users, well, you know, if users are used to cPanel, they might be a little adverse at first, but I think they'll quickly see it's got all the same features. It's just actually laid out a little nicer. One of the nice things is they have these hook scripts that run before and after everything that it would do, so you can easily hook up your own custom stuff or do whatever you need to do to customize it.
No, that's very cool.
He also asked about using jails.
Mm-hmm.
It depends. You know, you could set up the whole direct admin to be inside a jail if you wanted, but doing like a separate jail for each customer, you get into complications where, you know, you would need a separate IP address for each one, and then you'd have to have some kind of web server in front or something. And there's a bunch of issues there. You could probably do it, but it wasn't a setup I've really bothered to investigate. I mostly just used the SUExec and SUPHP so that the scripts run as the user that owns them, rather than running as one common user across everybody. And then it's easier to lock down the permissions and make sure that, you know, if somebody exploits WordPress on user A, they can't go and mess with user B's files. You know, when they get a shell from doing the exploit or whatever, you can't really protect each individual site, but you can try to prevent cross-contamination.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. Okay. I hope Alan answered your question there. Next up, we have kind of a cool thank you from Henson. I'll go ahead and just read a little bit of this. It's actually kind of cool. I just want to thank you guys for making the BSD Now show. You've inspired me to switch to FreeBSD, and after a week of running 10 current, I couldn't be happier. Migrating from Linux wasn't nearly as scary as I thought. Very cool. And I believe anyone who's run Arch or Gentoo in the past would have no issues. Now, that's really cool to hear.
Yep.
Let's see here. And keep up the great tutorials. The one on Ccache and TempFS really made running 10 current, which I believe has no binary packages right now. Well, they'll be coming very soon. Mm-hmm. Very palatable. The only issue I've run into was trying to compile Firefox on a 2 GB TempFS partition. It's crazy how large these browsers are getting. Yeah, to give you an idea, I got, my builds were 196 gigs of memory, so I can run 16 TempFS builders simultaneously. Yeah. I mean, especially when I see like four OpenOffice builds fire up at the same time, it's going to get big.
Yeah, for that kind of, I was like, you know, you can put the whole Ccache into a TempFS and then back it up when you're done so that, you know,
because
you can keep that cache and it'll help your next bulk build. But when you're building the whole ports tree, having even the CC cache be in RAM as well. Although, if you're putting it, if it's being saved on top of ZFS, then the ARC is already going to do a good job of keeping it nice and hot. So it's probably not.
Well, cool thing, I did switch our builder to using Ccache for the entire port stream. I think I had to bump the size up to like 8 GB, so it's getting mostly cache hits now. But it works. It's pretty nice.
Yep. I talked to Baptiste about Poudriere in the jail, and it's not quite there yet. There's a bunch of issues, but apparently a lot of people are running it in Beehive, so we're going to set that up for you.
Oh, okay. Virtualize it. Very cool.
Which will do everything we needed it to do anyway. So, and it'll also mean that I'll have a little more flexibility on the host machine that way.
Okay. Well, very cool. Thanks, Alan. Okay, here. So let's see. He wraps it up with, I'm still a beginner, but from what I hear about compatibility, DTrace, ZFS, and PF, I think FreeBSD could be at a tipping point. I'm glad you guys are leading the charge. So thank you, Henson. That's actually really cool.
Yeah, we're glad to do it. And we're trying to incorporate more of that stuff into the installer. Devin Teske and I have been working basically tirelessly since on the way out to EuroBSDCon, integrating ZFS into the installer, also supporting Geli encryption in the installer, and a bunch of other things to try to make things easier. Also, Warren Block has contributed a couple of very useful patches just to make it easier. One of the interesting things that I hadn't thought of, because one of the first questions in the installer is, what kind of keyboard do you have? Or it was rather, do you have a strange keyboard?
Right? Yes, yes. And
so I changed the default to no, because that was easier for me. But then Warren was like, the worst part is, you say, yes, I have a strange keyboard, and you pick what you think is the right one to describe your keyboard, and then it continues the install.
Oh, and you don't know if you got the right,
right.
one.
Right. So he wrote a patch that gives you a test dial, basically a text box you can type in and make sure it comes out right. And then you can say, yes, that was the right one, or no, let me try a different one.
Yeah, that's important. That's what we had to do in our GUI. Yeah. You get a nice little text area where it's like, you should type something in now and make sure that so works the way you thought.
When you press this button, does the right letter come out? Because I remember I was using a KVM system, like a remote keyboard, to type on a server in England. And their keyboard layout is slightly different. Yeah. And so when I tried to type a dollar sign, it didn't make a dollar sign. It made like the hash symbol or something. And
that was the problem we ran into. People would type their username in, and like the A through Z characters worked fine. But then when you'd start doing the special characters for like your password, like it wouldn't have been what you thought.
Yeah. And so I actually ended up
and can't log
locked
in.
out of my machine, because when I set the password over the KVM, when I pressed, you know, a certain symbol, it made a different symbol. So when I tried to log in over SSH, password doesn't work because I didn't make the wrong symbol.
Okay. Well, that actually looks like it wraps up the show for this week, Alan.
Yep.
So as usual, guys, all the tutorials are going to be posted in their entirety at bsdnow.tv. So you can refer back to that, and that'll include the scripts and documents so you can see exactly what we did. And as usual, send your questions, comments, show ideas, and topics, pretty much anything, to feedback at bsdnow.tv. And, of course, we don't necessarily check YouTube comments, JB comments, or Reddit, et cetera. So if you want us to see it, please send it in via email to the feedback account.
Yep.
Twitter is also acceptable. We do try and monitor that. And, of course, watch us live every week, Wednesday at 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC. Yep. So anything else you want to mention here before we wrap up, Alan?
I think that's about it.
Okay.
Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll catch up with you next week.